We're so glad you're here to listen to this week's sermon from Park Street Church. Park Street is a historic congregation located in the heart of Boston. But more than that, we're a community of people from all different backgrounds who believe and are united by the good news that Jesus is Lord. If you're asking questions about God, your faith, or the meaning and purpose of life, we would love to connect with you. Visit us at parkstreet.org to learn about our community. We hope this sermon encourages you today.
Please turn back with me in your Bibles to Luke chapter 10 and verses 38 to 42 as we reflect on this passage this morning. And as we do so, let me pray for us. Father, in your light, we see light. And so we pray that you would come now and by your Holy Spirit illuminate the reading and the preaching of your word so that we would see Jesus more clearly, love him more dearly, and follow him more nearly. And we ask this in his name, the one who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever praised. Amen. Have you ever been in someone's home as a guest when a domestic tiff occurs? You know, you're there for a meal, and the husband and the wife start arguing in front of you, or one of the children is disobedient and the parent has to deal with them. Have you ever experienced that? It's awkward, isn't it? I had such an experience a number of years ago. I'd called in to see my friends Clark and Lee. They'd just been married, and a few weeks after their wedding, I went to see them, and they invited me to stay for dinner, and we were sitting there enjoying dinner together. And then the doorbell went, and it was his business partner with his wife and little five-year-old son. And so they came in and they were sitting at the table and we were talking. And then the father, the business partner, decided to take his five-year-old son to meet Clark's dog in the back room off the kitchen. Now, this was not a pet poodle. This was a big, excitable boxer dog. And when I say big, I mean big. And when I say excitable, I mean excitable. And we're just chatting away at the table. And then next thing we hear this huge scream. And the little boy comes running round the kitchen table and the boxer dog's coming after him. And we're all up from the chair trying to grab the boy, trying to grab the dog. And the boy jumps into his mother's arms. And once we've got the dog under control, she turns to her husband and says, "You always take it a step too far." And next thing, this huge ding-dong starts happening between the two of them. I mean, what do you do? Anyone for a pickled onion? They're really nice. It was so awkward. Now, maybe you haven't experienced something that intense, but I'm sure you've still been in a home and there's a bit of tension between the husband and wife or between the parents and the children. It's an awkward thing, isn't it? What do you do? Well, the one thing you don't do is take sides. Can you imagine that day in Clark's house when the husband and wife were arguing back and forth and I said, "Mate, I'm with your wife. I think you do take it a step too far." Or can you imagine I'd said to the wife, "Look, come on, relax. Let's just give the boy to the dog and then we can all have our dinner." I mean, can you imagine taking a side in an argument like that? That's what you don't do. You ask for the pepper to be passed. The one thing you don't do is take sides. Well, Jesus tells us a story of Jesus caught in the awkward moment of a domestic tiff between two sisters. And it's a domestic tiff in which Jesus takes a side. And out of which Jesus brings a profound lesson for our Christian lives. The story is quite a simple one. It's only four verses long, but the point of the story is often missed because we tend to read this story as an either-or choice that Martha and Mary faced. On a superficial reading, we tend to think that this story is about the choice between either serving or listening. The choice between the busy life and the quiet life, the hyperactive life and the contemplative life. But a closer look at the story reveals that that's not the point at all. In fact, we really only get Jesus' point if we first feel the tension of this disagreement and understand why Martha is so miffed. Because the case that Martha brings to Jesus about her sister's actions, or rather inaction, has some merit to it. I mean, picture the scene. Martha has invited Jesus and his 12 disciples into her home. She's the host, and therefore the pressure rests on her shoulders. And what a pressure it is. At the very least, there are 13 hungry men to feed. The numbers alone would bring some stress into the home. And then there's the rooms to prepare. There's the water to fetch. There's the food to buy, prepare, cook, serve. Any person here who regularly practices hospitality or entertains guests knows exactly how Martha would have been feeling. Now, add into that mix the issue of Mary, her sister, verse 39. And she had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. Now, we don't really get the offensiveness of what Mary does here in our 21st century Western world. But at best, Mary's actions are culturally inappropriate. At worst, they're downright thoughtless and insensitive. In this culture, women were generally not allowed to be disciples. Yet here is Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus in the posture of a disciple. You may recall Paul in Acts 22 said that he sat at the feet of Gamaliel, his teacher. It was the position of a disciple. And in this culture, only men were allowed to be disciples of rabbis, of teachers. Yet here is Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus, listening to his word in a room full of men. So it was outside the bounds of cultural etiquette. But that actually isn't really Martha's beef. Martha's beef is that Mary isn't helping with the corned beef. In this culture, women prepared and served food in a home. It was simply the done thing. Men sat, women served. This was the culture. So we can understand her when she comes to Jesus, verse 40, and says, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her to help me." Martha's annoyance is surely understandable. It's not like Mary's an invited guest who might be relieved of helping in the kitchen because she's a guest. No, she's Martha's sister. How can Mary think it's reasonable to leave her sister Martha on her own to prepare everything? So given Mary's thoughtlessness, we can understand why Martha feels as she does. And hence, she goes to Jesus and asks him for help. Her question in verse 40 is rhetorical. She's expecting the answer, yes. "Do you not care, Lord?" "Yes, of course I care, Martha." "Then tell her to help me." Notice she no longer calls Mary by her name. "My sister, tell her to help me." So we can feel the tension. Given the cultural etiquette, given there's 1,300 hungry men in the house to feed, provide for, we can understand that it is a reasonable rant that Martha has. Isn't it? Well, according to Jesus, no, it's not. That's the surprising thing in this passage. Jesus is not on Martha's side. He's actually on Mary's side. Look at verse 41 and 42. "But the Lord answered her, 'Martha, Martha, you're anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. Notice the tenderness in which Jesus addresses Martha. The double pronouncement of her name conveys affection and compassion. He's not on her side. He's about to offer a rebuke, but he couches his words with love and affection. Martha, Martha. But then comes the stinging rebuke. Martha, Martha. You are anxious and troubled about many things, but only one thing is necessary. Notice how Jesus positions the words many and one in contrast to each other here. The one thing clearly relates to Mary sitting at Jesus' feet, listening to his teaching. Mary has chosen the one thing that is better, the spiritual food of God's word. That's what the word portion is implying here. You know, like we say, can you pass me a portion of Brussels sprouts, please? Well, Jesus is speaking about a portion of spiritual food here. In other words, Mary has chosen to be involved in another kind of meal with Jesus. Now, in the background here, it may be Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. But I think there's a closer connection. It's the passage that we read earlier in the service, Psalm 73, verse 25 and 26. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Jesus is saying that Mary has chosen him and his teaching as the good food, the good portion. She's feasting on Christ. She's nourishing herself on his word. When this is your food, Martha, it will not be taken away from you. You see, Martha had failed to do the one necessary thing, to listen in humble submission to the word of the Lord. The idea of humble submission here is seen in Mary's posture, sitting at the feet of Jesus. This is the one thing that is needed when life is frantic and busy, listening in humble submission to the word of the Lord. But we mustn't misunderstand Jesus' point here. He isn't presenting Martha with an either-or choice, serving or listening, busyness or quietness, the hyperactive life or the contemplative life. There are a number of things in the passage that show us that Jesus isn't giving her an either-or choice. Look again at verse 42. Jesus isn't lambasting Martha for doing the wrong thing. He hasn't said, Martha, Mary is doing what is right and you're doing what's wrong. No, he simply says that Mary has chosen what is good. Can be translated also better. She's chosen the better portion, which means that what Martha is doing is at one level good and right. It's just that what Mary does is better. Jesus' issue with Martha is that she's worried and upset by the many things. Not that the many things in themselves are wrong. Jesus is not saying, Martha, we don't need a meal. Just come and join the Bible study. It's not about the beetroot. Forget the beetroot. It's about the Bible. He's not a Platonist. He doesn't have a divide between spiritual and physical, as if food doesn't matter to him. You read the Gospels, and what does Jesus do in the Gospels? He literally eats his way through the Gospels. He's always eating. He's always drinking. Do you remember what he was accused of? Being a glutton and a drunkard, which meant he must have enjoyed his food and his wine enough to be accused of it. He was the man of Ecclesiastes, par excellence, who knew what it was to properly enjoy and handle the good gifts God had given him. He's not opposed to having some food. He wasn't on a fast at this point in his life. He was expecting food. If you look back at chapter 10 and verse 8, as he commissions his disciples to go out on a mission, he says, "Whenever you enter a town and they receive you, eat what is set before you." And then look at verse 38. "Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home." What is Jesus expecting here? He's expecting a meal from Martha. He's on a journey to Jerusalem, and he and his disciples need to rest and they need to eat. And he's not unsympathetic to the amount of work that would have took. He knows it's a lot of work to feed 13 hungry men. He's not saying, "Martha, stop fretting about the beetroot and come and feast on the Bible." It's about the Bible, not beetroot, Martha. That's not what Jesus is saying. He's expecting a meal from her. Indeed, when we look closer at the text, we see that Mary was most likely initially serving alongside Martha. If you look again at verse 40, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone?" Martha doesn't say that Mary never helped her, but that Mary left her to be on her own to serve, which implies that Mary first served in the kitchen and then went and sat down and listened to Jesus in the living room. That's the nuance here in the story. Jesus doesn't present Martha with an either-or choice, serving or listening, busy life or quiet life. No, Mary served and then listened. And it was her listening that put her serving in proportion. Martha's serving consumed her listening, so that in the end she lost all proportion and perspective. And that, in a nutshell, is what this story is all about. It's about perspective. It's about proportion. It's about priority. To use the words of Jesus, it's about choosing the better portion. If I could put it in one sentence, it's this: the many important things of life need to be ordered by the one necessary thing in life, listening in humble submission to the word of the Lord. The many important things of life need to be ordered by the one necessary thing in life, listening in humble submission to the word of the Lord. And when we do that, when we allow the many important things in life to be ordered by, prioritized by, put in proportion by, the one necessary thing in life, listening in humble submission to the word of the Lord, then life is not as complicated as we may think or as we may make it. In fact, Jesus's point is that we can't serve effectively with the hand without first listening humbly with the ear. And that's the one necessary thing that's needed. The ear gives perspective to the hand. It's ear first, then hand. And when we get the proportion right, then we have chosen the better thing. I think this story is such a timely reminder for us, because we live in a hyperactive world, don't we? Where busyness is the new business of life. Perhaps even as you've been listening to me, you've been thinking, that's not a Philadelphian accent. So I need to find out what's going on there. I've got those emails I need to respond to. I need to do this for my kids this week. I need to go visit this person this week. I need to do this. I need to do that. We live in a busy, distracted world, and even when we come to church, that busyness often doesn't leave us. Well, the first thing we need to recognize is that the Lord Jesus does not present us with an either-or choice. He doesn't say, "Forget about all those earthly things, all those temporary things. They're fleeting. They're all passing away. Forget about all those things. Just read your Bible. He knows about the many important things in our lives. He understands that they need to be done. He knows we have a to-do list. He knows the diapers need to be changed, the children need to be taken to school, lunches need to be made, meals cooked, exams revised for, an inbox that needs replies, grandchildren to look after, vacuuming, grass cutting, shopping, problems to sort out. He knows our to-do list. He doesn't tell us, put it in the bin, just read your Bible. He's not presenting us with an either-or. What he's saying is, those important things of life, of which there are many, need to be ordered by the one necessary thing in life, listening in humble submission to the word of the Lord, feasting on Christ. He is the portion that helps us put everything else into proportion. We see it with Mary. She centers and orders, she prioritizes her serving around the one necessary thing of listening in humble submission to the word of the Lord. It's not that she doesn't serve at all. It's that her serving is ordered by her listening, and her listening gives her serving the right perspective and the right proportion. If I could put it like this, Mary made Christ her portion, and so she kept everything else in proportion. Unless we do the one necessary thing of listening in humble submission to the Lord, we will lose perspective. We will lose proportion to the many important things in our lives. That's what happened for Martha. She lost perspective because she got so taken up with the many important things in preparing the meal, she forgot the one necessary thing: listening in humble submission to the word of the Lord. And that's what God says to us this morning. Let the many important things of your life be ordered by the one necessary thing in life: listening in humble submission to the word of the Lord. Now, in case you think that this is a sermon about your personal quiet time, notice where Mary is. She's not having a wee one-on-one Bible study with Jesus in the conservatory. No, she's in the living room with other people. She's listening to the word of the Lord in community. Mary's at church. Think about who's there. The head of the church, Jesus, his apostles, and other people, I'm sure, as well. She's at church. She's listening to the word of the Lord at church. Yes, it's good to have a quiet time, spend some time in the Word and pray on your own. Jesus speaks about going into your room and closing the door. It's important to have that. But this passage isn't about quiet times, it's about church times. Gathering together as believers, listening to Jesus, the head of the church, speak to us through his word, and sitting in humble submission under it, Sunday by Sunday. And when we do that, then we gain perspective on all the other things that we need to do in our lives. But I want to close by asking a question, and that is, how did Martha lose perspective while Mary kept perspective? How? Okay. It's the Northern Irish accent. How did Martha lose perspective while Mary kept perspective? Remember a number of years ago hearing an evangelical minister tell the story of a time he was on a fraternal, and he got talking during the coffee break to one of the other ministers, who was a charismatic minister, who told him that every morning when he's shaving, Jesus comes into his bathroom and they talk together. And this evangelical minister said, Sorry, let me just get this right. You're saying that when you're shaving in your bathroom in the morning, Jesus of Nazareth comes into your bathroom and talks to you? He said, yeah. He said, let me just get this right. You're saying Jesus of Nazareth, who lived 2,000 years ago, who died on a cross and rose again, that he comes into your bathroom when you're shaving and you talk to him? He said, yeah. He said, sorry, let me just get this right. You're saying Jesus of Nazareth, born of a virgin, suffered under Pontius Pilate, crucified on a cross, raised on the third day, ascended to the Father's right hand, is being worshipped by angels in heaven, that Jesus comes into your bathroom and talks to you while you're shaving? And he said, yeah. He said, it sounds like you don't believe me. And the evangelical minister said, well, I've only got one question for you. Do you keep shaving? And then he said to him, because if the risen, glorified Lord Jesus Christ came into my bathroom when I was shaving, I'd fall at his feet and worship him. You see, the problem with Martha is she had lost who was sitting in her living room. Mary understood who was sitting in her living in Martha's living room. And so she went to sit at Jesus' feet. Martha hadn't really grasped who Jesus was, and it's because she became so occupied with herself. Three times in these four short verses, the title Lord is used. Yet in her words to Jesus, Martha speaks about herself three times. Verse 40, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Then tell her to help me. Three times Lord is mentioned in four verses. Three times Martha speaks about herself in one verse. She's lost perspective because she's missed who's sitting in her house, and it's now all become about me, 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 me. Martha, Martha, he whom angels worship and before whom demons tremble is in your home. And you're worried about the potatoes. Should we boil them or bake them? Should we fry them or roast them? What way does Jesus like his potatoes? Martha, Martha, prophets and kings wanted to see what you see and to hear what you have the chance to hear. Prophets and kings, Martha, but you're worried about the cauliflower. Should I serve it plain or should we do it with a creamy sauce? Martha, Martha, the queen of Sheba came from the ends of the earth to listen to Solomon. And one greater than Solomon is teaching in your front living room. And you're worried about what to serve for dessert. Martha lost all perspective because she didn't grasp Jesus' identity. The Lord, the one upon whom the end of the ages had dawned, the Savior of the world, was in her home. And she's more worried about whether it's cream or ice cream with the apple crumble. What Jesus says to Martha is, Martha, Martha, in light of my identity, a simple meal would have done. And then you also could have come and ate another meal that would never have been taken away from you. Because when I am your portion, Martha, it gives everything else its right proportion. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as we gather Lord's Day by Lord's Day, and during the week in various settings to sit in humble submission to the word of the Lord, let us not forget who it is we're hearing from. It's Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, whom angels worship and before whom demons tremble. Between the two services this morning, I went and stood out on the street. I was amazed how many tourists were walking by, or visitors doing the Freedom Trail and hearing about this historic church. And I thought to myself, imagine we said to them, do you know who's in there? You know who's speaking in there today? No. The President of the United States. Do you think they would have come in this morning? I think they would have. What, the President of the United States is going to address the people in this building? Yeah. Well, we have an even greater message to tell them. It's not the President of the United States who speaks in this building every Lord's Day. It's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Do you want to come and hear him? He's got something to say. When we get his identity, then we come to church. Then we sit in humble submission under his word, and then it puts everything else into proportion. Let's pray. Father, we live such busy and distracted lives. In our sin, we are easily taken away from our focus on Christ, on feasting on him through your word each Lord's Day. We ask, Father, that you would give to us a resolve and a resolution to be those like Mary who are committed to sitting at the feet of our Lord, listening to his word and feeding upon him. So please, Lord, help us to keep the many important things in our lives in right perspective and proportion, because Christ is the one we follow and listen to. And we ask all of this in his name and for his glory. Amen.